Kia ora and welcome to the Front Row, TVNZ's show and podcast, talking all things rugby as we lead into the all-important Rugby World Cup, which is next month. Scotty Stevenson, Paul Moore, with me on the panel. Too excited about the fact
that
it's next month.
How exciting is that? Next month.
Okay, I should stop yelling because otherwise I'm just going to get very annoyed at
how
me.
How good?
But how good. Now, first though.
I'm a bit worried now.
Are you worried? Are you worried because of the performance against the Springboks, or are you worried?
just bite up.
Steve Hansen calling on us to have patience after that performance against the Springboks over the weekend. 16-all draw. What did you make of it, Mr. Stevenson?
I was there, actually. I watched from the stands. I had my eye on a couple of players in particular. I wanted to see how Matt Todd went, and I'm really stoked that he's in the squad. More on that later. But I think Steve Hansen's got a point. We have seen this before and at the start of the All Blacks season, and I think given this year they have really settled on a game plan, they've got to get everyone back together. They've played two teams in two different weeks with a week build-up each, as Steve Hansen said yesterday in his press conference. And there's rust. There's a lot of rust, don't get me wrong, and there's a lot of toes for fingers, but they're still playing a lot of footy, and I think they'll be reasonably happy.
He'll have the CRC out this week, and he'll be hitting the rust.
Correct.
The other thing, too, is the All Blacks themselves have been two completely different teams over two weeks.
Right.
And then we're going to see that honed down now that we've made the cuts. They're going to take the Bledisloe incredibly seriously, and then I think this plan will start to materialise for those of us that don't know what the plan is.
Fingers crossed, because it does kind of concern me, though. You know, you get to this point in time where you're going, there are only three tests left between now and the World Cup, and that opener against the Springboks, the all-important opener. First of all, though, let's have a look from that Springboks game at some of the key stats from the draw in Wellington. So a try apiece, the All Blacks with the greater share of possession, though they conceded nearly 20 turnovers. Better than the 25 against Argentina, but still not great, is it? They did concede fewer penalties in the box, nowhere near as many missed tackles, and dominated in the metres carried stakes. You know what? You look at some of those stats and you actually think they probably should have won that.
They most definitely should have won the game. There is a risk of playing too much rugby, and the All Blacks have fallen into this trap before, and we've seen teams in Super Rugby fall into this trap as well. Quite often, you've just got to say to yourself, maybe we're better off without the ball here. South Africa aren't a team that you can accuse of being able to engineer 90-metre tries. As a general rule, we saw that in the World Cup semi-final in 2015, where the All Blacks just out-strategised the Springboks. Kicked deep, said, you run to us from 90 metres deep and we will stop you. I think the All Blacks wanted to go out there and play with tempo. In fact, they obviously want to play with tempo. But just sometimes when that doesn't come off, you've got to go to your plan B.
From a Springboks perspective, I mean, Razzy Erasmus was pretty open about the fact that he was coming here to play as, you know, his best team as much as he could to try and get that psychological advantage. Do you think, Paul, that they would have gotten that out of the draw?
They will think they've gotten that. They will think they've gotten that because they dominated the first half and then they came back at the end of the second half. And they're going to get their captain back, which will make that very good loose forward trio even better.
Yeah.
And they have got impact off the bench. They've got two amazing halfbacks.
All right.
And they've got impact off the bench. They will be happy.
Yeah. They were pretty impressive. I don't want to be like a harbinger of doom here or anything.
Let's panic.
Come on.
There's only a month to go and we drew with the Springboks. Let's panic. What are we going to do?
Are you suggesting that I might be overreacting here?
They're a good team. They're a good team and they're a smart team. And Rossi Erasmus is a smart coach. You know, the Springboks are still here. They've stayed in New Zealand for the week before they go to Argentina. They're
smart
soaking
move.
It all up, just thinking about it. Let's not only draw with the All Blacks on their home patch after beating them on the same stand last year. Now let's camp in their city.
Let's hang around
for another week, just hanging out like
mind
we
games.
Own the show.
Oh, we do love the mind games. All right, let's have a listen now to what Steve Hansen had to say after that draw.
We're trying to do something that's new, and they're not quite clear on that yet, how they're going about it. And sometimes we didn't even look like anything like what we were training. Yeah, we can see a fair bit of daylight at the end of the tunnel, so we just got to be patient.
Got to be patient.
Got to be patient.
So at what stage do you start panicking?
The day after the Springbok game?
No, I don't. You know, in fact, he doubled down on that comment yesterday at the Bledisloe Cup announcement too, where he said, you know, we saw enough to get us excited in those two performances. He said we took risks. He said the rewards were great and they allowed us to make decisions around players. That's what they used those two tests for. Now, we want them to win. Of course we do. We want them to look good doing that because it's the All Blacks and everyone expects that from them. But I think, as far as Steve Hansen's concerned, this was just get this out of the way, we'll move on to the next block.
Take what you can get from it, and they probably got what they wanted. What they did not want was a major injury. One of the big talking points of the weekend, poor Brody Retallick taken off the field with a dislocated shoulder. The good news, it wasn't as bad as we all feared after we saw him in this level of pain. Poor guy, you don't see that often. Steve Hansen says he's still a possible for the World Cup, but with it less than 8 weeks away now, in case we haven't talked about that enough, it is a bit of a race against the clock.
What about the Google search went up off the Richter scale during that test match for a dislocated shoulder recovery time?
I contributed to that statistic. That's what I was doing immediately as soon as he was going off the field. Now, if he comes back for this and trying to do all those mental calculations, if he comes back in time for this, will he be ready? Exactly. Exactly. It doesn't really matter.
Everyone's now
in quarterfinal.
Do you know the great thing, Kim, is that everyone's now an orthopaedic expert? It's like, well, there's no bone damage. It's only ligament damage. So you'll be fine in there. You can recover from that. Just do a few arm raises. He'll be all right. He'll be back.
You can't get the big guzzler out of the World Cup, can you? You can't.
No, exactly. And at least, I guess, now they've got Scott Barrett back from injury, so that's...
That's massive, right? And that's going to be interesting because all the talk, I think, over the coming weeks is who plays six. And I don't know if that's on your talking points today, Kim.
Believe it is.
Are we talking about this now or should we come back to it?
You know what? Let's come back to it very shortly because, for way of context, five players have been cut from the All Blacks squad ahead of the Bledisloe Test, which start next week in Perth. So we're now down to 34 players. These are the ones who have been released. I'm not sure how many surprises there are in there for you. I'm a little bit upset, personally, for Tuanu Kawafe, because, you know, he's a cult hero, he's a fan favourite. The Lucys, Shannon Frizzell, Dalton Popoli'i have gone as well. Joshuane will stick around now for development purposes for the second Bledisloe test, is that right?
He's still with the squad, so but he is there by invitation rather than selection. So that distinction was made pretty clearly yesterday. Asafo Almua played no minutes, so it was an opportunity. Shannon Frizzell had a big opportunity against the Springboks, just didn't do enough. Steve Hansen said yesterday they've settled on their six.
Who's the six?
Luke Jacobson is the only real specialist six in that side.
Fafita keeps hanging around. Fafita's
there as a lock six.
Scott Barrett's coming back.
Scotty Barrett comes
and
back.
And the captain's going to fit into the loose forward mix somewhere. If they keep Todd around, does that mean he's the backup seven? And
does Artie Savia move to
eight? Artie goes to number eight.
We love it.
Okay, I'm going to throw this at you, right? Everyone's so keen to see Kieran Reid shift around. The guy has played 119 test matches.
It's not about being keen, it's about what these selections are potentially telling us.
Artie Savia, Sam Kane, Kieran Reid, with potentially Matt Todd on the bench, you've got four of the best loose forwards in the world. But I just don't think you should be able to say to Kieran Reid, hey, you move. He has earned the right to play
eight. He's
the captain of the All Blacks. It's the same calls on Richie McCaw last time, where everyone said, oh, he's got too slow, maybe he should play blindside. Richie McCaw was like going, what? I've played 142 tests a number seven. Now you want to move
to not enough for you?
What?
And Kieran Reid will be at his very best at this World Cup. He's a long way from his best now. And the same thing, they said the same thing about Dan Carter at the last World Cup.
That's very true.
It feels to me a little bit like 99, where how do we fit Tana, Jonah, Goldie and Christian into a back line? Well, maybe we shouldn't have.
Let's not do that.
Let's hear from Steve Hansen again now on whether those players who have been cut have a fighting chance of making it to Japan.
They can jump back in the mix, but it's obviously getting harder, isn't it? Because we're trying to narrow it down, and we've got two big games coming up, and then we'll reflect and get it down to 31.
It doesn't sound like, short of injury, really, is there much of a chance at this point when they've still got a few good players that they still need to cut to get down to that 31-man squad for Japan?
That's right. And remember, Retallick and Ryan Crotty potentially have to come back as well. It's not just cutting four, it's maybe cutting six out of that. There's a lot of water to go under the bridge. There will be injuries. I'm sorry to say and I'm not going to sit there playing the injury lottery right now, but we have seen it in every World Cup that there will be injuries. So guys have just got to be patient, to coin a phrase, and hope for the best.
All right, let's move on to the team that we will be playing next, which is the Wallabies, their match against Argentina. The Wallabies won 16-10, not overly convincingly, one would say. I'm not sure how much you saw of the game, Scotty.
Yep, when watched the game, they had some moments. The Wallabies, I thought, and so did Argentina. Spare a thought for Argentina. They've lost 21 of their last 25 test matches, and the Wallabies are on the rebuild. They're without their best player. due to circumstances we're all familiar with. They're trying to build back into a game plan that is going to get them deep into a Rugby World Cup. They're not there yet, but they have a back line. Man, they've got a back line.
And I need to use it a lot because I have a fun stat for you, team.
Oh, yes, please, Kim.
I've brought a fun stat to the table. Right, so in the two tests of the Rugby Championship so far, the Wallabies have spent 78 seconds in the opposition 22, compared to the other three teams who are all around the five-minute mark from their two tests. Now, like you say, they've got a good back line. Tries don't necessarily come or originate from inside the 22, but it's a pressure thing, right? How are they supposed to build and accumulate a lot of pressure if they're not actually spending any time threatening that line?
Exactly. That's a rhetorical question.
That was a statement question.
They can't, but if you've got two centres like that, do you need to be that close?
Valid point.
Do you just bust through from 40 metres out, hook up with your wingers and your fullback?
They've just got to find a way to use those guys, right?
Yeah.
And they're not a driving team. They're not a mauling team. So they're not going to win games by taking five-metre lineouts and crashing over for tries. So they've got to find other ways.
Now, the game against the Pumas did also feature what I think is the feel-good story of the week. That is, of course, Christian Leliafano returning to the green and gold for the first time since being diagnosed with leukaemia 3 years ago. What a story of resilience he is. Diagnosed in 2016, he was told he may never play rugby again. But against the odds, he returned to professional rugby in 2017, this year bringing up his 150th Super Rugby cap with the Brumbies. Then on his return test against Argentina over the weekend, he contributed 11 of the Aussies' 16 points, kicking 3 penalties and a conversion. Auckland born, let's remember, former Waikato player. He has been chasing the World Cup dream for more than a decade now after being cut for the 2015 campaign at the final selection hurdle. He is set to move to Japan after this year's World Cup. What do you reckon his chances are of making that World Cup squad?
Massive.
Yeah, he's the driver.
Yeah, exactly.
He drives their bus.
Yeah. And not least just for the inspiration, the motivation, the leadership that we hear so much talked about. Here's what Aussie teammate Samu Kerevi had to say about how he inspires the team.
His aura about him, the buzz that he brings to the team, it's second to none. And you just have to go look back at what he's done with footy and what he's done with his life in the last couple of years to be where he is now. It's amazing, and it's credit to his family as well, the support system around him, and himself. Like I said, the resilience that he has.
That says it all, really. Right, back here. Super Rugby. Finally, we know what Geordie Barrett's doing in this tussle between the Canes and the Blues, inking a 3-year deal initially with the Canes, but with an option to switch teams after 1 year. Here's Canes Chief Executive Avon Lee.
Look, I won't lie, we're not thrilled, but at the end of the day, we've got Geordie back in the Hurricanes next year, and it's up to us now to prove to Geordie, in a way, that he's made the right decision.
Has he made the right decision?
Is it a decision? I'm not sure.
it's the ultimate fence sitting, isn't it?
It's a no decision.
Yeah. Sitting at the top of the Bombays, looking north, looking south.
We covered it last time on the show about this negotiation. It's been fairly fraught. The Hurricanes thought, well, look, here's the offer. The Blues said, we're going to offer you more. Geordie Barrett sitting in the middle going, I don't want to let you down. That looks pretty good. I want to play with my brother. But Bowden Barrett doesn't know whether he's going on sabbatical next year. So I think for Geordie, it was a case of saying, get into a franchise, put it out of your mind, because he's got bigger fish to fry right now. He's not exactly settled in that 31-man World Cup squad.
Exactly. And so, Steve Hansen's kind of talked about him recently, as well, talking about how he's kind of in a big rush. He's a 22-year-old in a big rush to do everything. Yeah. And whether that's, I guess, achieving at an international level or what he's doing when he's actually on the field, maybe he just needs to take a deep breath.
Have some patience.
That's right. It's the motif of today's
running through.
The front row. Patience.
That's right.
All right. Turning on to a much more serious topic now, because making waves on One News Now this week, the awful stories around a couple of incidents of referees being assaulted at grassroots level. Steve Hansen did address this at his press conference yesterday. Here are his thoughts.
We wouldn't have a game without referees. We get frustrated at our level with them, but we understand that they're human and they'll make mistakes and they're there to be supported. It's not right for anybody to hit anyone.
Can't say I disagree there. Now, Paul Moore, you do have something to add to that.
Yeah, so just...
I'm shielding up. I know you're going to lose it.
Oh, no.
I'm shielding.
First up, Ardmore Marist, which is where the young boy that was refereeing was assaulted, is my club. 2 weeks ago, I was there watching them play the county's club final, and I am steamed. I'm just... How shit do you have to be to think that this is okay? Do not do this. Do not. Why do you attack a 14-year-old kid refereeing a bunch of 11-year-old kids? How sad is your life? This is no. No.
Look, we got sent the video footage of the Middle March incident, and I know, speaking to friends who are referees, they were incensed. And not only incensed, but so upset. Yeah. In the vast majority of cases, these are volunteers who are out there trying their hardest. We have a major issue nationwide on sideline abuse, not just on referees, but on young kids trying their hardest. Yep. Everyone,
and not just in rugby, we should make the point as well.
Sport,
across
and
all sports.
Everyone knows the line. Mm. You know the line. Mm. We have got to stop crossing it. These are extreme examples. Mm. But everyone should be a little bit more cognizant of the damage their words can cause. Mm.
Yep.
And if those words can then spark actions like this, then we're in serious trouble in terms of our sideline spectators and our sideline support.
And the future of the game, because if you're out there as a youngster getting abused, you see referees being attacked, why would you want to keep playing?
Yeah,
why
exactly.
would you want to do this if this is what happens to you?
Exactly.
Why?
All right. Whew. Can't finish it on that heavy note. So finally, if you haven't heard, Air New Zealand has released a new safety video. All Blacks related, of course, in a World Cup year. Here's my personal favourite part.
When do you think they'll do the next All Blacks safety video?
4 more years, probably.
OK, come on. Scotty's not impressed. I thought it was funny. Scotty's sitting there with a look on his face that just says, what are you doing? Why have you put this in front of me?
It was funny at the time, George. It's the same gag.
New gag, George.
Just that was 16 years ago, George. 16 years ago.
We've won it 2 times in a row. And of course
still,
it gets old.
And he's still quite literally making money off it. I mean, that's just smart.
He's such a good boy.
He's a lovely man.
And also, good sense of humour from the All Blacks for allowing that to be a part of what's really a promotional video for them, because that shows that maybe there is a sense of humour in this game after all.
Madness.
Oh, you know, it's serious business. It's a serious business.
All right, that is all we have time for today. Thank you so much for joining us here on The Front Row. Any topics or burning issues you want to discuss, you can get in touch with us at thefrontrow@tvnz.co.nz. We'll be back next week. We will be talking all things Aussie ahead of Steve Hansen's second highest priority of this year.
No, we won't.
Second highest priority of this year, the first Bledisloe test. We will be.
Okay.
Mr. Stevenson, oh, you love it. All right, see you then.